Live from College Park, it's Sunday afternoon, and a beautiful one at that for a top 10 women's lacrosse matchup. It's the number 9 Denver Pioneers taking on the number 5 Maryland Terrapins. We welcome you into CQ Stadium, high atop Tizer Tower, Brennan Hartlove alongside Taylor Cummington-Seglio. Taylor, it's a beautiful day. It really does not get much better than this, and Maryland is going to be looking to kind of right some of the wrongs over the last couple games.
They're finally back at home. They've had a tough couple of battles the last few games, a key win against Florida, faced some adversity against Syracuse and JMU. If I know them, they're going to be trying to right the ship, get back on track.
But for Denver, it has been smooth sailing over the last couple games, including a big win over Michigan last time out.
Denver hasn't been at home much. They've been on the road quite a bit, had a lot of success, so they're used to playing in foreign territory. I'm really excited to watch them and see how they come out.
And a bit of history between these two programs. Last matched up in 2019, actually on this field, not Maryland's normal field, in the NCAA quarterfinals. Maryland got the win, you know, headed towards that national championship victory.
That was a great game. I was here in the stands as a fan. I'm excited to see these teams back on the field competing in the regular season. This is one I hope continues as the years go on.
And a bit of a personal game for Kathy Reese, Maryland's head coach. She was Denver's head coach from 2004 to 2006 before taking that Maryland job, and it has been nothing but success since then.
If there's two programs that I think hold a place in Kathy Reese's heart, it's Denver and Maryland. So I'm sure this is really special for her. She's great friends with Liza Kelly, the Denver coach. So I'm sure they're just, you know, really excited for a beautiful day to play some lacrosse.
And Liza Kelly, also in her 17th season, Kathy Reese in her 17th season at Maryland, she really has this program moving in the right direction.
She's so well respected in the lacrosse community. Every team that she has is talented, energetic. They just play lacrosse and a great brand of lacrosse. So excited to see this team take on the Terps.
And so as we kind of look at this matchup today, it is going to be a kind of unique battle. Maryland has had some particular challenges on offense trying to score those goals. And Denver, you know, is pretty well set up defensively.
Denver's zone is really, really tough. Rover Sam Thacker, who's a McDonough grad, who I coached for a few years, is really, really talented. She's kind of that glue in that defensive end. Maryland has struggled against zones against Syracuse and JMU, so I know they've put in some work this week and throughout the season to continue to improve on that. So I'm excited to see the adjustments that were made on Maryland's end and to see, you know, if Denver can and hang strong in that.
We are just about set for the opening draw here in College Park. We'll quickly get you the lineups for Maryland. It's Bosco, Sanchez, Lamoureux, Clevenger, May, Ahern, Rude, Smith, Donovan, Lubecker, Major, and Sterling in the cage. For Denver, it's McCoy, Black, Palmisano, DeRose, the sisters, Thacker, Jenkins, McPherson, Gilbert, Klingenberg, Curry, and in the cage is Bohee. We are set for opening draw in College Park. It's Abby Jenkins in there for Denver, facing off against Shea Ahern for the Terrapins. Underway on a sunny Sunday afternoon. An early whistle, and the Terps will be able to have the first offensive possession of the day, and we'll see if they can kind of right some of those wrongs we were talking about, Taylor, in terms of getting some good looks at the cage.
First possession, I think they're really going to just be focused on getting the ball around, getting a feel for what this Denver zone is like to play against live, and see where their openings can be throughout the game.
Here's Shea Ahern, the reigning Big Ten midfielder of the week. Works the far side for Elle Clevenger. She comes behind the cage now, draws a good bit of attention, and passes to the near side for Hannah Lubecker. Ahern again. Now Shannon Smith. As you said, Taylor, Terps just trying to move the ball around, but eventually they coughed it up, and not exactly the strongest first offensive possession the Kathy Reese would have wanted.
Definitely not. Again, you know, they're trying to get a feel for what this defense looks like. Denver's zone plays really stretched. They put a lot of ball pressure on, but that was a great ride there from Shannon Smith. If you're going to make a mistake at one end, it's great to kind of hustle your butt off and get the ball back on this end.
Here's Lubecker track back to make that challenge to win the ball back for Maryland. And a whistle, so the Terps will be able to have the restart.
If you're a young player tuning in, Shannon Smith had that turnover behind cage, and then she hauled her butt back to go create a check on that ride. So it's about when you make mistakes, being able to right the wrong, put in the hustle, and she was able to make up for it on the other end.
Here's Kate Seitz working inside, feeds to the middle. It's Victoria Hench, and she draws the whistle. So a good first opportunity here for Maryland to get on the board first.
I love that look from Kate Seitz. She really dodged her defender, forced that second slide to happen throughout the zone, found a streaking Victoria Hench. This is an area that the Terps have to capitalize on in their 8 meters.
Victoria Hench from the right center hash mark. Stares down the eyes of Bowie. Whistle goes. And a comfortable save in the end for the Denver goalkeeper.
I think Victoria Hench is going to want that one back. She probably could have taken another step or two from this angle. She only took one, didn't have a ton of power behind it. I think she'll, you know, now that she kind of has a feel for what Bohe does in cage, she's going to probably feel more comfortable running that in.
3 of 7 on the free position is Hench so far this season. And Denver gets things back underway. Here's Julia Gilbert, the senior captain. 2 goals in the last game against Michigan, wearing the number 24. Working behind the cage are the Pioneers. It's Kayla DeRose, fifth-year senior. Back up top. On the right hand now, forced back out is Ellie Curry, another captain for Denver. Seconds on the shot clock for Denver. Abby Bosco doing the defending for Maryland. Forces Sloan Kipp back outside. Inside on the left hand, a deflected shot. Trickles wide of the cage. And eventually scooped up again by Denver. 8 seconds on the shot clock for the Pioneers. Dodge to the left hand, and a whistle called. It'll be a shot clock violation against Denver, so Maryland will bring it back the other way.
Lori Kennis, Nadine Hanagi, defensive minds on that coaching staff, going to be happy with that first defensive play right there.
Here's Lou Becker trying to find a bit of space. She was going quickly. Feed into the middle. May is there, and her shot goes wide left. Scooped up by Hench. Quick transition by the Terrapins. They look to get things going on offense.
One of the ways you can beat a zone is in that transition game while everybody's kind of getting to their spots and getting set. So that's something that Maryland's going to have to push. You're going to have to push that transition, and I like those opportunities that they got from that.
Elle Clevenger was fouled, and she'll have the restart behind the cage for the Terrapins. Passes off to Libby May. Here's Shannon Smith. Clevenger again. May working on the right side. Passes up top. Now here's Victoria Hench. Lou Becker trying to work on the right hand. Forced back out. Denver set up in that zone that Maryland's had trouble breaking down this season. Clevenger. Pass to the middle. Shot there and a whistle. So Maryland again will have another good opportunity, but that was a bit better ball movement by the Terrapins.
Definitely better ball movement. I think their top players are a little bit too flat, so it's easier for those defenders to shift side to side. But great vision here from Eloise Clevenger, hitting a streaking Libby May. And then Denver just coming in a little too hot with that check. They were there. I think if they just played body, didn't get the swing, that could have been a turnover.
Libby May from the right center hash mark. 5 of 8 from the free position this season. And that one goes over again. The Terps come up empty once more on the free position, but they will maintain possession on the near side.
Denver's crashing really hard on these free positions. That's something that's never going to show up in a stat book, but it's really making Bowie's job a lot easier in cage, and it's really disrupting these Maryland shooters.
Lou Becker, now Shea Ahern. Passes over to the far side for May. Clevenger behind the cage, surveys her options. And a shot clock violation for the Terrapins. Not exactly the cleanest offensive game so far for either team.
Defenses are doing really well, so the defensive coordinators on both sides are going to be happy. But offenses are, you know, again, it's early, just trying to feel out what each other's doing, what the game plans are. But now that we're, what, 5 minutes into the game, I think offensive coordinators and head coaches are going to be looking to put the ball in the back of the net.
Up top for Gilbert once again. Passes off to DeRose. Here's Black on the left hand. Down the center, the shot and the save by Sterling.
Good save there from Sterling. Maryland's not going to want to let these Denver attackers and midfielders get to the middle of the cage. That was a really tough one to put on Emily Sterling, but she got it off the shaft of her stick and able to continue to keep this defensive possession alive.
And another save by Sterling, but a whistle behind the play. And will be the Terrapins ball coming out of the back.
That's one of my new favorite rules in recent years. When I was playing college, if an attacker, a midfielder shot and there was a foul, they got to redo it. And now if you take the risk of taking the shot and the goalie makes a save, it's the other team's ball. So I think it just keeps the attackers and midfielders honest a little bit.
Here's Clevenger from Maryland. A lot of contact there up high against Corey Edmondson, the freshman from Severn, Maryland. Baylor player you know very well from McDonough.
Yep, she's one that I've coached for 4 years at McDonough. Defensive player for Denver, got her pretty high. I'm surprised that wasn't a yellow card. But now Corey Edmondson on the line looking to make the third free position that Maryland's taken this game.
Sarah Picorni, the sophomore from Winter Park, Florida, with the foul. Here's Edmondson. Whistle goes. Third time's the charm for Maryland. The free position goal puts the Terps up by one over the Denver Pioneers.
Edmondson able to get a quicker start off the line than Victoria Hench and Libby May on the pass attempts. Quick start off the line, protects her stick really nicely. And then Bohe tends to play a little bit higher out in her crease, so she puts that low and away. A really, really smart decision. It's not the flashiest, but it went in the back of the net. 1-0 Terps.
They all count the same in the end. And we were talking before the game. It is interesting, Bohe, you talked about, plays a little higher out of that crease. How does that affect the mentality of the attackers?
It cuts down the angle at which you're able to shoot. You see less white of the net around her, so you either really have to move it around her and be really precise with your placement, or if you're going straight on, have to drop your stick and shoot around her. So it just forces you to really think a little bit, and with this high-pressure zone that Denver plays, it plays right into that kind of style, and it just disrupts these Maryland attackers a little bit from their thinking, from their quick releases, maybe not shooting the right places. And so that's going to be the challenge that they have to kind of face throughout the day.
Kind of that risk versus reward goalkeeping style. As Maryland controls the draw again, it's scooped up by the Terps. Edmondson has it, passes off, and the Terps will look to continue to push the lead. Here's Shea Ahern. Pretty good crowd here on a Sunday afternoon. Clevenger again runs into a bit of trouble, and it's scooped up by Denver. That's Anna Palmisano, the junior from Delray Beach, Florida. Started every game last season for the Pioneers and started every game to start 2023.
McCoy and Palmisano on that, just really kind of putting in a great double team on that end line. That end line's acting as another defender. So really Eloise Clevenger back there is triple teamed, and she tried to split. They held their positioning, and that's a good no call by the refs, I think.
Denver looks to get in their set now and respond to the Corey Edmondson goal. Here's Gilbert. Thought about the pass, now switches back onto the right hand, has it knocked out of her stick, scooped up by the Pioneers. Approaching 30 seconds left on the shot clock for Denver. Spin inside and knocked out of the stick once again of Curry that time. And picked back up. Gilbert thought about the shot, elects to go behind the cage now. 20 seconds. Reagan Wilson. So the whistle goes with 11 seconds left on the shot clock.
In contrast to Denver's zone, Maryland's playing a man-to-man zone, man-to-man defense. They're sending those early slides, and one of the tricks and perhaps risks that you take in sending those early slides are teams getting stuck in 3 seconds, which is exactly what happened right here.
So Reagan Wilson on the right side hash mark, likes to go to Cage, and it's saved by Sterling. She's come up big a couple times now here in the first quarter.
Probably got to feel good if you're Sterling. She's had, you know, I think a better last couple games, struggled sort of in that middle pack of those away games for the Terps, but she seems to be seeing the ball pretty well this game, which is a good thing for her.
Here's Lauren Black. Passes off to Gilbert. On the left hand, that one goes over top. 28 seconds left on the shot clock for the Pioneers. Here's Curry. Spins, and that one is trapped well by Sterling once again. Terps looking to play quickly here. Here's Abby Bosco on the release. Glides across midfield, absorbs a bit of contact. First whistle, keeps going. And then takes a lot of contact right as she was entering the 8-meter. That's the speed and tenacity that Abby Bosco has brought to this Maryland program over the last 2 years.
Bosco's little, but she is very, very tough. Denver coming in a little bit too hard from both sides, cross check on either side, kind of smushed in between two defenders. It'll be interesting to see whether she takes this or not. Looks like she is.
From the center hash mark, Bosco bounces that one wide. She doesn't often find herself in those kinds of positions.
I love that. Kathy Reese and coaching staff giving confidence to these defenders who really are that kickstart to that offense. So if they find themselves in that position, they do have the green light to score. So I love that take from Bosco. She shot it low and away. So they're able to get the ball back and kickstart their offense again.
If you sprint all that way and take that much contact, you deserve to have the shooting opportunity.
Absolutely. That's going to be a yellow card on Ellie Curry, I believe. Jordan Lipkin basically got hit in the head with a stick as she was cutting through, which is why we're now in this man-up situation for Maryland.
So Curry, the senior captain out of Lutherville, Maryland, takes a seat on the side.
Terps are now man up. This is an area for them that they've done really well in some games, and some games they've struggled with. So it'll be interesting to see how they've been making adjustments throughout the season.
Up top to Lubecker. Edmondson, the goal scorer. Clevenger. Maggie Wiseman into the game for the Terps. Edmondson. Clevenger gets it on the second attempt. Now Libby May has a shot, and that one goes wide. Clevenger gets it back underway. Lubecker. Edmondson through the middle, and she has her second. Corey Edmondson doubles Maryland's lead over Denver.
Maryland doing a really, really good job on that man-up opportunity, moving the ball, making that man-down zone with Denver shift. Corey Edmondson, I've seen this so many times, it made me smile. That ball comes across from her right shoulder. She pulls it across, able to use that defender's momentum against her, and then shoot around Bowie. So 2-0 Corey Edmondson against Denver.
We have a timeout here in College Park. We'll step aside. You're watching Women's Lacrosse on Big Ten Plus.
Lacrosse is special in Maryland. In our state, little girls have a stick in their hand. In our program, we represent the definition. We set the standard. 15 national champions. 28 final.
Back here in College Park, Brennan Hartlove, Taylor Cummings bringing the action to this top 10 women's lacrosse matchup. Amelia Bohe has been beaten twice by Corey Edmondson now, Maryland up 2-0. And we talked about kind of that strategy of playing higher in the crease. She's gotten beat twice, but she's also made some pretty good interventions.
Definitely. I think the Terps are 2-for-7 right now in their shooting, and a lot of their shots have gone wide, so they're not necessarily showing up as saves, but Bowie's doing a good job of cutting down angles, forcing those shooters to really try to hit the pipes, and she's the reason why they're shooting wide. So may not be showing up on the stat sheet as a save, but she's still being really effective in there.
Bohe credited with one save. Emily Sterling for Maryland with 4. And that is a fight for possession. Maryland had controlled the first two draws, and Denver scoops this one up, looking for a response. One of those crucial moments in the game with about 3.5 minutes left in the first quarter where if you're Denver, you don't want that lead to keep ballooning where it gets kind of out of reach, where it's a lot more difficult to come back later on in the game.
If it's make it, take it at the draw, it's really, really hard for offenses to build momentum. So that was a key draw win, a very timely draw win for Denver. They're going to be looking to build off of it and have a successful offensive possession.
Sophia LaBanca was trying to work her way through, and Maryland scoops it up. And the Terps will look to transition quickly down the other end. That's Clancy Rood striding forward. And Lubecker took a lot of contact again pretty high up. Looks like Gracie DeRose might have been the guilty party.
Lubecker is so fast. It's just amazing, especially from this view that we have up in Tizer Tower, of watching her kind of be able to just go 10 yards when people are going 5. Let's see if she can stick this.
And she puts that one wide again. And you saw a pretty good example over there, Bohe taking that big step out as soon as that whistle goes. Cut down the angle and kind of just getting ahead of the shooter a little bit as well. Emma Muchnick, the freshman in there for Maryland, wearing the number 36. Here she is now. Lubecker from the right-hand side. Chrissy Thomas now into the game. Draws pressure behind the cage, and now Maryland works it back up top. Lubecker tries to switch onto the left hand and couldn't quite connect with Muchnick going through the middle, and Bohe will scoop it up.
Maryland moved the ball really well on that offensive possession, but I'd like to see them utilize skip passes more. The pass from person to person just allows for a really quick shift for that zone. So if they're going to be able to dissect it, I think it needs to be more of a skip pass so that they're able to move the ball 2 people away and isolate that 3v2 or 4v3 on the backside.
And define a skip pass and how it would be kind of used in that context.
So if there's 3 people in a line, not hitting from A to B, but A to C.
Gotcha.
So just making sure that, again, those longer passes, while they're riskier, they cause that defense to have to shift more, which opens up the 3v2 on the backside when there is a rover that's taking cutters.
And it's less kind of telegraphed in a way where the defense isn't able to read that quite as easily if you're not exactly moving in a nice, clean pattern.
Absolutely.
So Denver now again looking to find something with 90 seconds left here in the first quarter. They would love to get a goal here before the break. Molly Eastep forced back out. Now Gilbert, defended by Edmondson. Tries to switch back onto the right hand. Edmondson does very well to keep her out. Little flip pass here. Still working on the left-hand side. Here's Black. And there's the goal! With time ticking down on the first quarter, Lauren Black finds the back of the net and cuts the deficit to just one.
The last couple of possessions, Denver's done a really great job picking, flipping, creating these exchanges that force the Maryland defense to have to really talk through and be quick in their reactions. They worked that for about 30, 40 seconds, and then Rue just got caught a step behind Black. Black able to put it low opposite hip against Sterling, which is a great play, which is great placement, especially against a really talented goalkeeper.
Lauren Black, all Big East first team last year. Sophomore from New Westminster, British Columbia. And we head back to the draw circle. Important draw here to control momentum going into the break. Pioneers come up with it and will bring it down. They very well could tie this game before the break.
They'll probably be holding for last shot, so my guess is they'll start their offense. 25, 30 seconds left to try to get a good opportunity before the quarter ends.
Kayla DeRose, a lot of local Maryland products on this Denver team. DeRose out of Gaithersburg. Here's Black. Drop that one, able to scoop it back up. Approaching 20 seconds left. Spin inside, there's the shot, and there's the goal. The Pioneers draw level with 18 seconds left in the first quarter.
Again, we're just getting back to that weave that Denver seems to really love. Sanchez does a great job stepping out on Gilbert right here, overplays her just slightly, and that's when she's able to feel that defender overplay, roll to the inside, switch to her left hand, and again, go low and away. So if you're Maryland, you're loving that they're exchanging really well, but they've got to be more solid in terms of not giving up that middle, which really just exposes Sterling.
11th goal of the season from the senior from McLean, Virginia. This game has turned on its head here in the last 90 seconds. And we're back to the draw circle. The Pioneers will have one last chance before the break. Here's Bryn McCoy trying to break through the pressure. Does so and gets a pass off. And that's the end of the first quarter. The mood has changed in the last 2 minutes or so as Maryland got out to an early 2-0 lead, and then the Pioneers have crawled back into this one. Taylor, what happened in the last 90 seconds?
I thought the Denver offense used their ball movement really well. I thought they used those exchanges, forced Maryland to, you know, overplay and capitalize. So excited to see how both teams come out in the second quarter.
We'll be back here for the second quarter. It's 2-2 on Big Ten Plus. Long time no see, folks. They came back to play 1 second. There was 1 second when the whistle went and the teams came back out. And every second is just as important as all the other ones we will play today. We made sure that you did not miss it. So we will be back here now for the second quarter in just a moment on Big Ten Plus. 2-2 between Maryland and Denver. Back here on Big Ten Plus, Brendan Hartlove, Taylor Cummings bringing you a top 10 matchup between Maryland and Denver. The game has changed, Taylor, and part of that has been, you know, looking at the draw circle. Now 3-2 in favor of Denver, but both of these are two very accomplished draw specialists.
Both Jenkins and Ahern, very, very dominant at the draw circle. They've really specialized their craft. It's an area that they really take a lot of pride in. We're 3-2, and the score is 2-2, so the saying, you know, win the draw, rule the world. It seems to be really telegraphing exactly how this game is going so far. Terps were up 2-0 on the draw. They were up 2-0 on the field. And then Denver started to get a little chippier, a little more aggressive on that draw circle, and were able to secure three at the end.
Shay Ahern for Maryland. She actually matched a career high with 14 draw controls in that game against Drexel a couple weeks ago. She's now fifth all-time in Maryland program draw controls, and I happen to be standing next to number one. So hearing her talk about that, I mean, she is the expert. And you've seen Shay Ahern kind of develop in that circle over the last couple of years. What have been kind of some of the things that have taken her from being a good draw specialist to that great level?
I think her communication to her circle people has really gotten so much better as she's gotten older. And part of that's a confidence thing and just being comfortable with, you know, the people that are on your team. But she really is able to keep them informed about where she thinks the draw is going to go. And those three people on the field, you're a team within the team in that draw circle. And she's done a really, really nice job of being able to have that be a part where Maryland's very successful.
So we've swapped ends and we're back underway for the second quarter. Tied at 2. Between number 5 Maryland and number 9 Denver.
Shay Ahern won that draw, but Denver swarming, hunting, challenging her to find a pass that was able to be clean, and she wasn't able to do it. They were able to get a check off, and now it's Denver possession.
Working on the right hand side, it's Sophia Labanca. Played in 5 games last season. She's appeared in all 6 so far this season, so an increased role. And a whistle against the Terrapins here. We'll stay with the Pioneers.
Kennedy Major called for an extension after that drop pass. Denver player Reagan Wilson had missed the ball, but that little extension from Major after that cut was made is why she's on the 8-meter right now.
Reagan Wilson from the right center hash mark. And that one is saved by Sterling. Pops high in the air. Whistle against Denver, and the Terps will be able to play from the back. Reagan Wilson has scored in the last 3 straight games for Denver and had a really good chance there. She is now 1-for-5 from the 8-meter this season. Here's Bosco sprinting away.
Great save there from Sterling, but an even better ground ball, air ball, if you can call it, from Marge Donovan. That's really, really difficult to find a ball going up into the air and dropping down, and she was able to secure that, but a costly turnover on the offensive end, and now Denver's looking to clear.
6th turnover of the afternoon for the Terrapins. Denver has 5. Here come the Pioneers. Works over to the right-hand side. Now back up top for Kayla DeRose from Good Counsel. Not far away. And another whistle in favor of the Pioneers.
Maddie Sanchez caught no man's land. She was sent that early slide, was that early slide, and then just had difficulty finding a Denver player to cover before the 3 seconds were up.
Julia Gilbert from the left center hash mark. Finishes into the side netting. Second of the day for Julia Gilbert, and Denver leads Maryland 3-2.
Not much Sterling could really do about that. That's just a great place shot. That's off stick side hip, had a lot of heat on it. She moves to the left a little bit, able to kind of pull Sterling just a hair. And then by going off stick side hip, it forces Sterling to figure out whether she's going to go over top for that save or underneath. She guessed right. She's just a little bit too slow.
So we are back to the draw circle. Denver leading Maryland in shots now 9-8. But the really telling stat is Denver leading Maryland in shots on goal. 7 for Denver, 3 for the Terrapins. Efficiency, not exactly the word of the day for Maryland thus far. They do control the draw. Will now look to move forward through Kennedy Major. Sprinting down the right-hand side. Draws the double team and is able to escape through.
Great composure there from Kennedy Major. Really, really smart too. She brought that stick in, rolled, controlled it. Maybe not the easiest way to clear the ball, but still successful.
The redshirt freshman missed all of last season due to injury, but she has come into this Maryland team from the get-go and really doesn't look like a player that missed all of a season ago.
I think with her injury being on the sideline, she was able to really learn and absorb the system. So even though she wasn't out there physically playing, she was able to really understand the key concepts, and she's so smart, such a smart player. It's been really, really exciting to see her on the field.
So Maryland will have a free position shot opportunity, and right now is actually the first time in the history of the series that Denver has led Maryland. Terps will look to put an end to that now. And that one ricochets back out, scooped up by the Terrapins.
That's kind of an unreal stat to think about, just considering how talented both these teams are, especially Denver. But they're up 3-2 right now. We're going to look to build on that.
And all credit to our Big Ten Plus crew for finding that stat. I will be honest, that is not one I had written down. How they found that out beyond me, but an incredible statistic that is quite telling of how this game has turned on its head completely. Here's Corey Edmondson, approaching 30 seconds left on the shot clock for the Terps. Elle Clevenger behind the cage now. Back up top. Lubecker tries to find an inch of space. Passes in the middle. There's May, and there's the goal. Tied at 3. Libby May on the doorstep to draw Maryland even.
Maryland's starting to utilize those skip passes a little bit more. You can also dodge against the zone, which is what Hannah Lubecker just did. She engaged that defender and then found a streaking Libby May. Libby May and Taylor Henshin on that inside, they were able to stagger their cuts as one went left, one split right. And then that's just great composure to catch with your right hand, turn, and throw low and away.
18th goal of the season for the senior from Sparks, Maryland. The National Offensive Player of the Week finds a goal today and an important one at that. I made sure to work in that Denver leading Maryland statistic when I could, knowing that there was a pretty good chance that at some point they would draw even once again. And who else but Libby May? Back to the draw circle. Whistle goes. And scooped up by Denver. They've been very impressive on the draw so far this afternoon.
McPherson's done a really good job getting the ball off the turf. She's using her body really well. She's reading where the ball's going in the air. And then instead of when everybody sticks her up, going up with them, she's waiting on the ground, able to hunt and fight. So that's just a skill that she's really perfected over the years during her time at Hopkins, during her time at Denver. Very impressed by her.
Trinity Hopkins, the graduate player, as you said, 4 years at Johns Hopkins, so has a bit of familiarity playing against Maryland year to year. Here's Gilbert. Sends back onto the right. Draws the double team. Inside a shot there, and Denver has the lead once more. Ellie Curry, the Big East midfielder of the week, puts it past Sterling and puts Denver in the lead.
Ellie Curry is very fast, able to take that right alley dodge. Rude does a good job forcing her to the right, but right at that last second, she moves her stick over to the front to try to get a stick on it. Ellie Curry tucks underneath and then is able to put it around Sterling.
Eighth goal of the season for the senior from Lutherville, Maryland, another one of those NDP players on the Pioneers roster. The Denver lead over Maryland. Even with 10 shots apiece, Denver been far more efficient. Crucial draw here once again. You know, in a game this tight in a top 10 matchup, it feels like that can be said for every draw that we have.
Yeah, these are going to, I think, tell the tale for the rest of the game. These have been a battle. Very few clean ones, lots of 50-50s. And as I say that, Corey Evanson gets ones really nicely clean.
She heard her coach upstairs talking about the lack of clean draws and said, I'll show you, coach. This is how we do it here. Up top for Shannon Smith. Clevenger, Terps, circling around. Maggie Wiseman, freshman. Now Clevenger. Edmondson, up top to Lubecker. Here's Shannon Smith. Horse back outside. Lubecker. May tried to corral in the center. Didn't have a ton of movement there. And Denver comes up with it.
That's one of those passes that Libby May looked open, but as a feeder, you have to question what is she going to do with the ball once she catches it. In that case, Libby May's back was completely to cage. There wasn't really going to be anything positive coming out of that pass. So that's one I would have loved to see Lubecker just move or dodge. Anything but that, really.
And you had a bit more time left to work with as well. So
definitely,
it wasn't exactly an urgent situation. And you and I were talking before the game about Maryland's kind of offensive struggles over the last couple games, and a lot of it is kind of between the ears. It is a bit more mental. It's not exactly a shooting slump. It's just kind of crafting those opportunities, not exactly the way we've seen Maryland do over the last couple of years.
They faced a few tough zones over the last couple of games. Zones in general cause you to have to think more. You have to figure out where they're shifting from, where the open person is. And so this is something that they're just having to kind of learn and grow from through their difficult schedule.
Ellie Curry couldn't quite connect with Sophia Labanca. And the Terps will get the ball back here with about 8 minutes left in the half. Here's Brianna Lamoureux. Actually had a career high in ground balls last game against James Madison with 4.
She was a player who was injured at the start of the season, didn't play the first game that we called. So it's good to see her back on the field. She's sort of a staple for this Maryland defense that, you know, is looking to build around some new faces.
one of those new faces now in Maggie Wiseman, the freshman. Edmondson through traffic, the shot, and that one, a fight for possession on the near side. Terps get a new shot clock. Clevenger up top for Smith. Comes all the way around and draws the whistle.
It's great to see Maggie Wiseman in the game. She's a player that has been getting more and more playing time as the season's gone on. She's a crafty lefty. And against a team like Denver, where your feeds have to come so quickly, having a player who's a natural lefty in that crease position is really going to allow them to be more successful and get more cuts, more feeds off sufficiently.
Here's Lou Becker at the top. Smith. Edmondson on the left-hand side. Back up top for Smith once more. Back to Edmondson. Lou Becker. Patient offense from the Terrapins. Edmondson runs into trouble. And that will be an offensive foul. Play will be stopped. Maryland had 13 seconds left on the shot clock.
I'm not sure about that one, I'm going to be quite honest. McPherson did get her feet set at the end, but the cross check to the neck, I think, happened prior to that. So I'm not sure about that one. But again, it's hard when you're watching it on a replay slow-mo, and live it looks a little bit different.
So Denver comes down the other way with a one-goal lead and 6 minutes left in the second quarter. Here's Gilbert. Had two goals in the last game against Michigan and has two here today against Maryland. Going playing against the Big Ten teams. Here's Estep. Also had two goals in the game against Michigan. Pass to the middle, couldn't quite connect. It was Black making the run. And that one almost scooped up. It was Caroline Collimore, sophomore from Hunt Valley, Maryland, for Denver, trying to chase that one down.
Love that defensive pressure from Marge Donovan there. Ball went over the 30. She and Libby May were able to double team and create a turnover for Maryland.
Clevenger for Maryland. Here's Lou Becker, the two-time All-American. Jordan Lipkin into the game for Maryland now. The sophomore had a very successful freshman season in 2022. Here she is now. Pass in the middle. There's May, and that one might have hit the foot of Bohee. Indeed it does, as Maryland gets a new shot clock.
Good movement there. Terps are starting to figure out where the openings are in this Denver zone. Now they're small openings, and they're quickly crashed upon, but they're doing a nice job working the ball.
Here's Lou Becker. And there's a hit there. So that's the kind of call we were looking for maybe a couple minutes ago.
That is going to be a yellow card on number 34 for Denver, Caroline Collimore. Just catches Hannah Lubecker right in the nose, mouth area. She had her set. She was able just to force her out, but that little extension at the end is what did it.
So a man-up opportunity for the Terrapins.
This is one they have to capitalize on. If they're going to draw yellow cards against such a tough defense, they have to put this in the back of the net.
4.5 minutes left in the second quarter. Terps back underway. Edmondson. Lou Becker. Libby May. Terps smell blood in the water as they circle the cage. Pass looking for Lipkin. And it goes to Denver, so a missed opportunity right there. Kind of at the start of that opportunity, Merrill not able to take advantage.
That one's going to hurt. You'd wasted maybe 20 seconds of your man-up opportunity, throw it away on a pass again that if that person had caught it, couldn't really do much with it. Right. Maryland needs to be more disciplined in their man-up opportunities. They need to move the ball, find the openings, and be able to put it at least a quality shot on cage.
So Denver in absolutely no rush whatsoever, trying to kill off this yellow card.
They will at some point have to go to cage just because their shot clock is less than the man-up opportunity that's remaining. But my guess is they probably won't go for another 20, 25 seconds.
About a six-second difference between the shot clock and the yellow card. Reagan Wilson gesturing to the referee, thinking that there should have been a foul there. Seconds on the shot clock for Denver. Wilson pulls things back out. Out Sloan Kipp. And a whistle as the yellow card, or as the shot clock was expiring, excuse me. That's a bit of a bailout.
That's going to be one. It's a 3-second call. It's the discipline thing coming back to haunt Maryland. They had the shot clock down to zero. That's where you've just got to really make sure everyone's marked up, everyone's out of the eight, because now Denver has an opportunity to get a 2-goal lead going into half, potentially.
5 seconds left on the yellow card, but it's Molly Estep from the right center hash mark. Whistle goes, Estep scores. Maryland had a man-up opportunity. Came up empty on the offensive possession. Denver comes the other way. The shot clock down to almost zero. And they give up the free position shot. Molly Estep puts it in, and Maryland trailing Denver by 2 now. And we have a timeout here in College Park. 5-2, Denver over Maryland. You're watching Women's Lacrosse on Big Ten Plus. Back here on Big Ten Plus, 5-3, the Denver lead over Maryland, and a couple players, Taylor, that were able to gather some honors in the past week or so for both teams.
Libby May, Shaylin Ahern having a great week for the Terps against Drexel in Florida. Denver's Ellie Curry having an exceptional week. These are three players that have been real standouts for today so far, so it's exciting to see them get recognized for all their hard work.
Now, Taylor, right before we went to that break was kind of a disappointing era of this game. I don't know any other way to put it, that just kind of that passage really left a lot to be desired from a Maryland perspective. The yellow card, not taking advantage of the man-up opportunity, then giving away the free position with virtually no time left on the shot clock.
I mean, Denver is doing a great job of capitalizing on mistakes. I'm not sure Maryland is doing the same right now. Denver, you know, was woman down, able to force either a shooting space or 3 second call. It was hard to kind of distinguish between the two at that last 1 second, able to put the ball away. And now Maryland's down two, Denver's up two. Maryland on the flip side, having difficulty to capitalizing on man up opportunities on free positions. So a lot of that just comes down to discipline and details.
So now the second time that Denver has ever led Maryland in history. And another control for the Pioneers.
Denver doing a nice job there. Gilbert won the draw, worked it back around, switched fields. Yes, they took, you know, 25, 30 seconds off their shot clock, but the ball is safely on their offensive end. Really impressed with their composure and their discipline.
There's Kayla DeRose. Working it X behind the cage. Passes off to East Depp. Throws again. Pass into the center from Black. Couldn't quite connect. Bosco was fighting for it with East Depp, and Maryland will be able to play from the back.
Good defensive set for Maryland there. Able to get on Cutter's hands, force the ball to kind of be passed behind them because they're doing a nice job with their defensive pressure on ball. So, again, a good win for Maryland on the defensive end. Let's see if they can come back down on the offensive end and put it in the back of the net.
Under a minute to play here in the first half. Terps trail by two. Maryland looking to find a bit of momentum before heading into the locker room. Here's Jordan Lipkin, the sophomore. Back up top to Edmondson, the freshman, part of this young Maryland offensive contingency. Hench got the ball, and there was a whistle, so we'll stay with the Terrapins. About 25 seconds left.
Good ball movement results in a free position shot. It's off the hanging hash, so not sure if Torrey Hench is going to take this or not, but at least, you know, Terps are doing the work to get the ball moving.
She elects not to shoot and passes it back, and Maryland again circles it around. Here's May. Edmondson. Smith. Forced back around. 3 seconds left. And it's scooped up by Denver. And that is the end of the first half. Maryland not able to find anything on the final offensive possession of the second quarter. And Taylor, not exactly what Maryland would have wanted going into the locker room.
They were able to get some shot, like a good possession off of it, able to generate a free position shot, but getting nothing on cage, it's kind of a dagger to the heart. I think if you're both offensive coordinators for both Maryland and Denver, a 3-5 game after 30 minutes of play, I think you're hoping for more. Maryland obviously hoping for a little bit more since they're the ones down.
Terps jumped out to a 2-0 lead early on, and then Denver has stormed back here to lead Maryland at the break. 5-3, the Denver lead over the Pioneers. You're watching Women's Lacrosse on Big Ten Plus. We welcome you back to Big Ten Plus here in College Park. Brendan Hartlove, Taylor Cummings bringing you a top 10 matchup between Maryland and Denver. And Taylor, it's been a fascinating game so far as Denver is out to a 5-3 lead over Maryland, but it started with the Terps jumping out up 2-0.
It's really been a defensive chess match, I'd say. Offenses on both sides having to figure out where the gives are in each defense, and there haven't been many with 8 total goals. Goalie's playing well, but again, I think on both ends, it's just a matter of who's going to be more disciplined. That's the team that's going to be the most successful.
In the first quarter, it ended 2-2, and then Denver, a 3-1 second quarter. They found some really good shooting opportunities, and they took them.
Definitely. They're able to get shots on cage. They're working this Maryland defense deep into their own shot clock, sometimes with 1 second left. And again, just capitalizing on the mistakes in a way that the Maryland offense isn't capitalizing on the Denver mistakes.
And another point of emphasis is that Denver has been 2 of 4 from the free position shot, and Maryland just 1 of their 6.
Zones are very susceptible to 3 seconds to shooting space. Maryland is doing a good job working the ball to create those opportunities. Now they have to take advantage of the free position shots and stick them.
And that has really kind of been one of the key things today as we're almost set here for the second half. But as we kind of look at the halftime stats, it has been fairly close, kind of what we were expecting in this game.
Yeah, I think things to note, Denver's fouls, 15-6. A lot of those fouls are considered the 3 seconds in the shooting space, so not necessarily cross checks or big heavy swings. Draw control battle, 5-5. I think the big thing, turnovers, 8-10 coming into a second half. Very, very high. Speaking for both coaches and as a coach myself, ideally you want that total number for a whole game to be under 10.
Yeah.
So we're nearing there. If you're Denver, we're already there if you're Maryland. So that's, again, a discipline, a decision-making thing that both coaches are going to look to kind of firm up on in the second half.
Maryland averaging 9.4 turnovers a game this season. And as we said, they have already surpassed that, and for Denver, they're averaging about 13.4 turnovers per game. So not quite there yet, but Maryland, typically a fairly clean team in terms of taking care of the ball. We've just seen some kind of uncharacteristic mistakes from Maryland.
Uncharacteristic, early in the shot clock, very untimely mistakes. If you're getting late into a shot clock, you're always looking, for instance, that last play from Shannon Smith at the end there. There's 5 seconds left in the entire half. You're going to throw it into the middle and hope it goes in. But when you're giving up the ball 20, 30 seconds into a possession clock, especially man up, that's where those discipline things come into effect.
So we go back to the draw circle to open the second half. 5 apiece in that category. Shay Ahern still in there for the Terrapins. Abby Jenkins for the Pioneers. We're underway. Clean take by Denver. They will attack from left to right here in the third quarter of action.
Really impressed with Reagan Wilson on that. Able to outjump Abby Bosco and secure that ball cleanly off the draw. Denver's able with this possession, if they score, to double up Maryland.
We made mention of it earlier on when Denver first took that lead over Maryland. 3-2. It was the first time that Denver had ever led Maryland in the history of the series. Maryland certainly getting the better of Denver historically, but the Pioneers on top at the moment. Here's Wilson. Passes off up top. Here's Gilbert on a hat trick. And there it is! Third of the day for the senior captain. And Denver is doubling up Maryland here to start the second half.
Nice little move there from Julia Gilbert. She's done this twice now where she pulls to the outside, sees Sanchez is overplaying her, and then rolls to the middle. Sanchez needs to play her with a little bit deeper of an angle. She's already going to the outside, which is where Maryland's defense is forcing them. She's overplaying, able to roll back in. So a really great opportunity and take from Gilbert. Not the most disciplined one-on-one defense there from Sanchez.
Second team All Big East a season ago was Julia Gilbert. She had 2 goals in the last game against a ranked Michigan team, and she has 3 here today against number 5 Maryland. Maryland wasn't really able to gather much momentum going into the locker room at the end of the half. Denver has stormed out here. Another fight on the turf for this one. And eventually scooped up by Denver. That's Trinity McPherson once again. As you made mention to earlier, has been really good kind of getting that ball off the turf.
Denver's doing a nice job of keeping the ball loose. Maryland looked like they had it clean. They get those extra little poke checks in. They start to kind of surround in twos and threes, and McPherson able to pick the ball up off the turf.
Pioneers go to work once again. Here's Gilbert. A hat trick already for two quarters and change. Here's Sloan Kipp. Goes behind the cage now to Eastep. Now Black. We'll flip pass here to Gilbert. Beats to the right. Here's Curry. Looking to go to Cage, and that time it's saved by Sterling. Still stays with Denver. New shot clock as well for the Pioneers.
This is a long defensive possession if you're Maryland. Denver worked that possession, original possession, down to 20 seconds maybe. Sterling with a great save, but now it's pushed to 60.
Here's Eastep. On to Rhodes. On the shot clock for Denver. Here's Curry. Sterling pulled well out of her cage, stays with Denver. Wilson wraps around the far side, runs into trouble. That was Major and Rude scoops it up off the turf for Maryland.
I think that was a good no call there. Attacker for Denver, a little bit out of control. Major able to hold her ground. Let's see if Maryland can make the most of this possession and put one on the board.
First sniff of offense for Maryland here in the second half. And they don't even get it anywhere near the cage. Another careless foul for Maryland.
Maryland's really trying to push the tempo and get the ball over the 30. Throws a risky pass, and then I believe it was Sam Thacker able just to intercept. So, again, a careless turnover that really cost them. Puts more pressure on the defense that just played about a 80-second defensive possession.
Now they're back on their heels once again. Here's Kayla DeRose. DeRose again. Now Black. The Canadian storming through the lane, and there's the goal once more. Seven to three, the Denver lead over Maryland. And we're only minutes into the second half.
Love this move here from Black. She's a lefty. She pulls across her face, and then there's three converging Maryland defenders on her. And she does a perfect job of protecting her stick, keeping it within her shoulders, and then able to put it past Sterling.
Makes no mistake on the finish. Lauren Black's eighth goal of the season and her second this afternoon. Taylor, one of the telling statistics, and we talked about this a little bit earlier on, is that the teams are pretty close in terms of the number of shots, 14 to 12 in favor of Denver. But 12 of Denver's 14 shots have been on goal, 6 of Maryland's 12.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at even the shooting percentage right here on the screen, 7 for 14, you're at 50%. 3 for 12, you're at 25%. ideally, teams are shooting above 50% in women's lacrosse. So Denver hitting those marks, key right on. Maryland, if it was they were 50%, it'd be a 7-6 game right now.
I know this gets tossed around a lot, but this is a crucial offensive possession for Maryland right now. Truly their first of the second half. Here's Hench, the Lubecker, May, Clevenger. To the far side now for Wiseman. There's that skip pass to Hench. As Lubecker in the center, Clevenger keeps it behind the cage. Now Wiseman. Edmondson, May, Lubecker. Tries to penetrate inside, can't do so. Edmondson scoops it up. 30 seconds on the shot clock for the Terrapins. Wiseman. The referee will bring play back.
I think somebody pushed the shot clock up to 60. There was no shot, so I think the refs are just resetting the shot clock to the appropriate time, I believe. Okay, so we're at 22 seconds on the shot clock now.
As if Maryland didn't have enough trouble getting into an offensive rhythm. And an errant pass there by Shea Ahern. Clevenger stays with it. May, inside off the post. Picked up and worked around to May once more. Terps do get a new shot clock. So a bit more breathing room to work with. Hench. She was fouled.
Unlucky there from Libby May on this foul. That's a foul I'm actually willing to give up. If I'm Denver, it's outside the 12. It slows the ball down. Tori Hench had her defender beat. That's one that I'd actually be okay with as a coach.
Up top to May. Ahern gets it back. Lubecker. Passes over to the right. Edmondson, two goals on the day. Wiseman. Clevenger around and in. Maryland stops the bleeding through L. Clevenger. Clevenger's sixth goal of the season and continues to cut the deficit down. Now Maryland trailing by three.
If you're Maryland, this is something to obviously be happy about. We put a ball in the back of the net. But what I'm very excited about is the fact that they worked the ball. They got a couple of quality possessions off of. Eloise Clevenger does a good job getting her hips around. So overall, good possession. Now they need to string some together if you're a Terp fan.
And so that was something where you had the errant pass that looked like it might have killed that possession, but it didn't. They picked it up. They were able to continue to work that ball like you were talking about. And Clevenger ends up putting it in the back of the cage. What kind of resiliency does that show for Maryland here? They've been taking a beating a little bit here in the last couple minutes.
I think to be able to kind of right a mistake to, you know, it was an errant pass, it was almost a turnover, and then they're able to make something out of it. Sometimes that's what it takes. It's a spark that's needed. It doesn't always have to be the most perfect spark. Maybe this is the moment that Maryland needed to kind of settle themselves down, take a breath, and feel like they can actually hang with this Denver D.
So Elle Clevenger, she got the goal, but she's been playing provider this season, actually leads the Big Ten in assists and is seventh nationally. We saw her really kind of round that into her game last year where she was just, and it was a lot of times to Aurora accordingly, but just kind of being that provider. So when somebody gets a goal like that, she's not quite always the one you expect to be in those moments.
No, she's usually the one facilitating. She's usually the one who's able to put it in the back of the net, help others put it in the back of the net. But on that time, she's able to do it herself.
And Julia Gilbert has been one doing it herself for Denver so far today. She has three goals on four shots, and you just kind of got some of the looks there What has impressed you about her game so far today?
I think she has a great sense of where defenders are on her body. If defenders are underplaying her and kind of not giving her enough pressure, she'll slip to the outside. If they overplay her as she's driving to the outside, she'll roll to the inside. And I think that awareness of being able to read defenders and read where, you know, where her, where they are in relation to her body is a huge skill, and it's something that, you know, isn't taught. It's learned and it's inherited throughout her years of play.
So during that timeout, they've actually been able to, with Maryland Women's Lacrosse playing at CQ Stadium this season, as the Maryland Field Hockey and Lacrosse Complex is undergoing renovations. The Terps have found a new home, but one of the benefits of that is that you now have a video board. So we've really been able to kind of see some of the history, see some of the great content for Maryland Women's Lacrosse, and taking a page out of the Maryland basketball playbook. They've done a Maryland Pride video this year, and Taylor, you are the last one in that video, which is kind of the biggest honor of already being honored of being in that video.
That was a shocker to me. I get so distracted up here because I love to watch all the videos. But, you know, I think one of the benefits to being in this stadium is this Jumbotron, and it was really fun to be an alum and to be able to put, you know, a little video together for the Terps of today.
And so you talk about kind of playing in the stadium. It's nice because, A, it's a bigger field, and you mentioned earlier that over at the Plex, it's the minimum regulation size field. But there are challenges to it as well here. Playing, kind of losing in the stands and things like that, it is not always the easiest place to play.
Definitely a little different than quiet, quaint home at Field Hockey Lax, but I think it's something that the girls are really excited about.
And Lubecker puts it in. The Terps, a quick double. The Clevenger goal fired Maryland up, and Hannah Lubecker finds the back of the net to bring Maryland within two.
I think something that a lot of players and coaches forget is you can still dodge against a zone. Hannah Lubecker does a great job rolling, resetting, and then as you see, Trinity McPherson, goes to almost go back to her home in that zone, and she's able to slip underneath of her. So that's something, dodging is a strength of this Maryland team, and sometimes I think when we play against zones, teams will forget that you can still dodge, especially to initiate slides and movements, and Hannah Lubecker does a great job right there on a solo take, able to put another one in the back of the net and chip away.
Lubecker, first of the day, 12th of the season for the senior attacker out of Forest Hill, Maryland. Two-time All-American, as we mentioned earlier. She actually had 62 goals last season, which was still only third best on the team.
Really talented player. She's somebody that, you know, the Terps are going to need to rely on to bring a spark, and she's done her part with that. Now they just need to be able to put some together.
Denver once again controls the draw. The Pioneers will look to find a response. They were the ones kind of dictating the tempo of this game here throughout the second and early parts of the third quarter. But two quick goals from Maryland, Clevenger and Lubecker, have made this game a bit more attainable for the Terrapins. And Denver will have to continue that offensive efficiency that we've talked about so much to make sure that Maryland doesn't get back into this one.
Well, their draw teams did their part. They were able to win a really key draw. I think this draw battle between the Terps and Denver is pretty close, but I'd say the timing of the draws on Denver's part has been huge and very much in part of why, you know, they're winning this game right now.
Here's Gilbert. Now Curry. Looking to go against Bosco. Now DeRose behind the cage. E-step almost lost it, able to get it on the second time of asking. And that time an errant pass, scooped up by Edmondson. Terps looking to transition quickly.
That's two McDonough friends turn foe on that transition. Corey Edmondson against Sam Thacker right there.
May tries the behind the back. And that will be a yellow card. Taylor, something tells me you don't quite agree with that.
That's such a heartbreaking moment and decision right there. Terps able to get a nice turnover transition opportunity, and then Libby May goes for the Twizzler, hits Sam Thacker right on the legs. That's a dangerous shot. a two-minute yellow card. Again, there's a time and place for those kinds of shots. In some instances, they really work. In that, I just don't think it was necessary.
So, again, kind of that roller coaster for Maryland earlier on in the first half. They had that one-up opportunity. They ended up turning it over and then conceding that free position goal with no time left on the shot clock. So the highs to lows, and again, you had that there. I think you're going to capitalize on that turnover, and it ends up playing at a disadvantage for 2 minutes. So a really good opportunity here for the Pioneers. They haven't needed the aid of yellow cards to find the back of the cage much this afternoon.
You'll see a contrast to Denver's woman down a defense as opposed to Maryland. Maryland plays a man-to-man, man down, whereas Denver plays a zone. So a little bit different. Their goal is to try to leave the person farthest away from the cage open and then shift around. Whereas in Denver's man-down defense, they sort of, everybody has their home and their slides are just a little bit longer.
Rose tiptoeing the crease. Couldn't quite connect. And again, a fight for possession. And Maryland comes out on top with the whistle.
That's an opportunity for Denver now. Not so disciplined, right? That was a crashing defense. There are players that could have been much more wide open on the offensive end. So that's one that Liza Kelly is not going to be too thrilled about if you're Denver.
There was a green card issued there to Lauren Black for Denver. She looked fairly confused as to why that was the case, but nonetheless, she finds herself on the side as well.
I'm a little confused as well.
It did seem to kind of happen after the play or something like that.
It may have been a failure to give enough space to Abby Bosco, but that's my guess.
Well, nonetheless, either way, she's on the sideline, and Maryland looking to attack now. Herb's trying to break through here, and there's that eager goalkeeping we talked about from Bohe. And it's scooped up by the Pioneers. That's Bryn McCoy. And here comes Denver. McPherson on the run.
Again, Maryland just too eager. With a green card, you're up for a minute. So I'm not sure why they didn't just settle, get into their woman up opportunity. Or at that point, it would have been a woman up opportunity. And now they're on their heels again on the defensive end, having to make a save. If they had capitalized on both those opportunities, it would be a 7-7 game right now.
Story of what ifs this afternoon for Maryland. The Rose, the Black. Trying to work through, draws the double team and a lot of contact there. Came up high as well, so another yellow card issued to Maryland. This time it's Abby Bosco.
Black here does a great job dodging. I guess there's a little bit of an extension from Abby Bosco. Had she just held her ground, I think that would have been a charge, but that extension into the neck area, on replay, that does look like a yellow.
Lauren Black with two goals so far this afternoon. Denver is 2 of 4 from the 8-meter today. And Sterling gets low.
Great save there from Sterling. That's a key victory and a key save if you're Maryland in that defensive set. I'd call that a W for them.
Sixth save of the afternoon for Emily Sterling, the reigning National Goalkeeper of the Year. And we talk about the what-ifs of Maryland kind of making the most of those offensive possessions, but, I mean, Emily Sterling has been doing a really good job of keeping this game as close as it is.
She's doing her job. She's trying her best. She's making some key saves and key moments, and none bigger than that. Now Maryland has the opportunity to run off this card and then also, you know, have a couple of seconds to be able to put it in the back of the net.
We have a timeout here in College Park, it seems, with under 2 minutes left here in the third quarter. We will step aside here on Big Ten Plus. Denver leads Maryland 7-5. back here on Big Ten Plus. Well, we heard the horn. It seemed like there was going to be a timeout. Then it seemed like nobody wanted to leave the field. And so we came back for 1 second in the first half. And, I mean, folks, we just couldn't stay away from you. We're enjoying this way too much today. That it looks like we're going to be back underway here momentarily.
So I think there was confusion perhaps over the yellow cards. They look to all be kind of all the refs down at the table look to be surrounding Abby Bosco, but unsure. Either way, Terps are going to have about a 30-second differential between this card and the shot clock, so they're going to have to go to cage man down, which against the zone is difficult, against Denver's zone, very difficult.
We'll see how the Terps approach this one, as there still seems to be plenty of confusion down there on the sideline. Eventually, Maggie Wiseman goes in for Kennedy Major. The reassuring part is that everybody else in the stadium looks as confused as we are, so it doesn't seem like we're missing anything. But nonetheless, it will be Maryland's ball to get us started here. 1:55 left here in the third quarter. Have a look there at Liza Kelly. And again, we are still just trying to work this out on the sidelines. And it seems they have come to some sort of conclusion.
Coaches look confused. I just heard a fan say, no way, that's right. So I'm not sure what they're hearing down there that right. Perhaps we can't hear up here.
They don't know what's going on, but they know it's wrong. And the official on the near side is still conferring with the Denver coaches. We came back from break thinking we were going to be underway any second now, and as it turns out,
we could have taken a commercial.
We could have. But this riveting action, and we are finally back underway. And remember when I said that Wiseman came in for Major? Yeah, they just switched back again. So Maryland's going to try to work off this yellow card. Kind of a weird thing to come back from as well. You have the confusion and kind of the lull, and then when you come back in the play, the team is trying to not do anything exciting. Mm-hmm. So, but here's Lubecker and Hench. Things starting to pick up a little bit now. Here's Edmondson. Has two goals today, and she makes it three. A cheeky finish on the doorstep from Corey Edmondson. And Maryland has brought it within one.
Both teams have scored man down on their offensive end this game. Corey Edmondson dodging hard, going to the outside, and then slipping underneath, and a cheeky little Twizzler. That's a time where keeping it in your right hand, doing that little Twizzler makes sense. I've seen her in these high-pressure moments as her coach put the team on her back. She's doing it as a freshman here. It just can't help but bring a smile to my face.
Hat trick for Corey Edmondson. Sixth goal this season for the freshman out of Severn, Maryland. She had an assist in her debut when we called that game, and she continues to impress for Kathy Reese's team. We joked about the lack of activity and lack of excitement coming out of that confusing referee conversation. Corey Edmondson said, I'm tired of waiting around. I'm going to go score. And she did. And we have a minute left here in the third.
Big draw here. Let's see who ends up getting it. And it's Maryland.
Bodies hit the turf, and the Terps come up with it. Ahern spins away.
They're still going to be woman down in this for another 10, 15 seconds, I believe. So they'll probably be able to finish this quarter with about 30 seconds left. And now it looks there to be a timeout.
We think. There are 38.9 seconds left. The team seem to want to go to timeout this time, and we will step aside as well. The Terrapins have brought it within one. Denver leads Maryland 7-6. You're watching Women's Lacrosse on Big Ten Plus. A one-goal game in College Park between number 5 and number 9. Denver leads Maryland 7-6, and Corey Edmondson for Maryland, the freshman, former McDonough player Taylor, she now has a hat trick.
She's doing a nice job of letting the game come to her in this instance. You know, she's taking her opportunities when she has them. She's going hard, and she's forcing that Denver zone to actually play one-on-one defense. And when they're not doing a great job, she's able to expose them.
She has been the catalyst for Maryland as the teams retake the field. About 39 seconds left here in the third quarter. We will pick things up with Maryland in their offensive half.
Abby Bosco seems to be up from her yellow card chair, so I think she's going to be heading back onto the field in just a few seconds now.
Here's Shea Ahern. Now Lou Becker. Lost out of her stick, able to pick it back up. 20 seconds left or so. Edmondson to Ahern. Here's Clevenger. And that one is knocked loose and scooped up by Denver with 5 seconds left in the third. And that will take us to the end of the quarter. It has been an exciting one in the third. 3 goals for Maryland as they climb back into this one. We will step aside here. Denver leads Maryland 7-6. You're watching Women's Lacrosse on Big Ten Plus. College Park, the place to be on a Sunday afternoon, is number 9 Denver leads number 5 Maryland 7-6. And Taylor, as we kind of look at the gap between Denver and Maryland over the last couple of years, you look at the margins. They've been getting smaller over time, but now they're in the lead.
They're doing a great job today, and every year they are just getting better and better. They're getting high-quality recruits. It's a place that players are excited to go visit. They're excited to go commit to and play at. So I'm not surprised that this is as close as it is. And I just think this is, you know, the start of hopefully these teams competing year in and year out.
Certainly has been a fun matchup over the past couple of years. We talked about the last time these two teams played was in 2019 in the NCAA quarterfinals, a pretty big stage for that kind of contest. And for that to be the closest Denver has ever made it until today is a pretty good feather in their collective cap. Back to the draw circle. Tied at 8 in that category, although in terms of kind of the momentum of the draws, it feels like Denver has been winning a lot more of them.
Yeah, it's hard for me to pick out some like really notable Maryland wins, but Denver, every time Maryland seems to close the gap or chip away, they get one, and that's just a huge momentum killer.
Final 15 minutes of regulation underway in College Park. Denver will get it first off the bat here in the fourth as they attack right to left.
Case in point, right there.
Denver has 15 shots, and 13 of them have been on frame, calling Sterling into action 6 times.
Denver's got to be careful. They've started to overthrow some of their passes. A couple have gone over the 30s. They're able to win possession back, but that's something that's happened the last couple of possessions.
Here's Lauren Black. Passes off to Gilbert. Looks to attack against Rude. Spins inside, now comes into contact with Bosco. Curry now. Rude switches off. E-step now. Around to the near side. Gilbert. Pass into the middle. Great intervention by Maryland's defense. That was Marge Donovan, a transfer from Princeton with a pretty big defensive play.
Before that defensive play, Rude and Bosco did a great job on Gilbert. Gilbert was starting to roll back. Bosco was there to kind of close that gap, force her to go back to the outside. That roll to the inside has been absolutely killing Maryland. So that's a smart adjustment for Maryland on their defensive end. Now they are able to get the ball back and hopefully put one in the back of the net if you're a Terp fan.
Now trailing by only one. Biggest deficit of the day for Maryland, I believe, was 6-3. Now here's Shea Ahern. Clevenger. Now Hench. Scored the winner over Florida with 17 seconds left in regulation. One of those big game players for Maryland in this young season. L. Clevenger passes towards the front, trying to find Wiseman. It's scooped up by Ahern. And a whistle goes.
Good little dodge and re-dodge there from Ahern. She's on the free position line. This has been an area in which Maryland has generated quite a few, but not had a ton of success in putting it in the back of the net. Hopefully she's able to stick it in the back of the net for the Terps. Again, if you're a Terp fan.
1 of 6 Maryland is from the 8-meter. And a save there. A good one at that from the sophomore, Amelia Bowie. Was always going to be a tough ask from that far left hash mark.
Interesting that Shea Ahern decided to take that lefty. She almost decreased her angle there. I understand it from the perspective of getting your stick away from that crashing Denver defense that has been really successful at getting sticks on it, but kind of surprised she didn't take it with her right, try to slip underneath.
Here comes Denver once more. First whistle goes as it's Bryn McCoy trying to get it across, the junior from Leesburg, Virginia.
Loving this Maryland ride. They're really putting the pressure on, making it tough for these Denver defenders to get the ball over the 30 successfully.
And eventually they do so. And we will have another timeout in College Park, he said quizzically. Nonetheless, Denver leads Maryland 7-6. You're watching Women's Lacrosse here on Big Ten Plus. Seven to six is the Denver lead over Maryland as we are into the fourth quarter of action in College Park. Brendan Hartlove and Taylor Cummings bringing you the action. And Taylor, you know Kathy Reese very well. What is the message to that team in this huddle where today has kind of been a bit of an uphill battle?
You know, I think she's really just talking about this current defensive possession right now, being disciplined, working them, forcing Denver to make a mistake. And then I think a lot of that conversation went towards the offense as well of, okay, when we get the ball back, this is what we need to do.
The Pioneers get things back underway. Gilbert tried to get the flip pass, and it's scooped up by Bosco. Rolls forward across the midfield line. And it looks like it will stay with Maryland, but a great defensive play by Abby Bosco.
I love that. Coming out of a timeout, you double the ball right away, put a little bit of pressure on Denver. I think Denver was expecting to maybe be able to work some clock off that. So I love that. An aggressive decision there from Lori Kennis, defensive coordinator. That worked out in their favor, and now they have the ball back.
Bosco has three ground balls on the day, two caused turnovers, kind of the heart at all of Denver's frustration in a way.
She's done a great job getting on hands. The last defensive possession, she was that slide that kind of prohibited them from rolling back inside. I think fans right now are unhappy with the held stick call against Bosco right there, but she's really had a great game, and she's starting to build off some prior excellent games in the past.
2022 Big Ten Defensive Player of the Year, Abby Bosco, and she was preseason National Defender of the Year. So a lot of high expectations coming into 2023 for Abby Bosco. Wiseman does really well to escape trouble here. Now the Terps get set.
We notice at the top of this Denver zone, number 16, Sam Thacker, she's that rover. So oftentimes her back may be towards ball, and she's looking to pick up cutters in the inside. Has really been kind of that thorn in Maryland's side all day.
Here's Elle Clevenger, the far side now. May runs into some trouble. Here's Hench. Now Lubecker. Operating from the right-hand side now. Clevenger. And passes it right into the stick of Bryn McCoy. 15th turnover of the afternoon for Maryland. They average about 9 a game. And here comes Denver. Through the center is Wilson. A tough shot, but a good save by Sterling.
That's one that Wilson, I think, should have held on to. Maryland was getting back in. They were not in the correct spaces to be in, and they're the ones trying to fight back and claw back. Denver's at the advantage right now. They have the ability to slow, waste a lot of time, so I'm really surprised that she shot that.
So Maryland will have the ball on the restart here through Shea Ahern on the near side.
Maryland has to capitalize on this. They forced a couple of unwise decisions from Denver. Now they have to be able to put it in the back of the net.
Clevenger to Edmondson. Here's Wiseman. Hench forced out to the left-hand side. Clevenger. Edmondson back to Clevenger. Under 30 seconds on the shot clock.
The point of this Maryland offense, so where Lubecker is right now, they're just getting a little bit too high, and that's where it's preventing these 3 seconds and shooting space calls from being called.
Hinge through the middle, and that one goes wide. We'll stay with Maryland. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Lubecker into the middle, and that one flicks just wide. And a shot clock violation for the Terrapins. They had a couple good looks, couldn't quite make anything of it, and Denver now comes the opposite direction.
It's a big defensive stand if you're Denver.
8 minutes left in regulation.
This is where sort of the chess match of possession time really gets into play. Denver able to kind of whittle this down to 6.5 minutes, a little bit more. My guess is they're going to take quite a chunk of the possession clock off.
Here's DeRose. Back out to Gilbert. E-step. Defended by Lamoureux. Back up top to Curry. She's been a bit quiet here recently.
Lean it now, Molly. Get low, get low.
Gilbert on Bosco. Wilson. Around to the far side. Donovan in pursuit. Here's DeRose. Draws the double team up top. On the left hand. Feeds in, and it's broken up. And Maryland whistled for a foul with 8 seconds left on the shot clock. They've been here before today.
They did a really good job kind of forcing Denver to move the ball, work. They weren't winning their one-on-one matchups. And then just a defender on that backside, Corey Evanson, got caught just a little bit too much of a hold trying to check that stick.
E-step from the left hash mark. Inside on Sterling, and it's saved. Follow up, and that one's over top. We'll stay with Wilson.
That's one that if you're Maryland, you have to pick that ball up off the turf. You have to win that run out at the end line because you've now given Denver 45 more seconds to be able to get a shot off, and you've already played a pretty lengthy defensive possession.
Gilbert. Orchestrating from the top, able to pick that one back up off the ground. Draws the double team. Tries to spin through it, cannot do so, and comes back out to the near side. Here's E-step. Curry, Big East midfielder of the week. Inside, and it's in! Curry gets her second of the day and puts Denver up by 2 over Maryland.
Love that take from Curry there. She just sweeps left to right across the top. Marge Donovan stays on her body, tries to go for that check, and then that's a high-to-high save that usually Emily Sterling makes. But that sweep across the field kind of forced Sterling to shift in her cage, move with her, and then she shot back to where she came from.
We have a timeout here in College Park as Denver has pushed their lead up to 2. So the 9th goal of the season for Ellie Curry. Maryland has 6 minutes left to find 2 goals. And, you know, Taylor, it is the definition of crunch time for Maryland. They've kind of been back and forth in the draw circle. They haven't made the most of their offensive opportunities. How do you kind of correct those areas to make the most of it in the last 6 minutes?
I mean, Maryland's been most successful on the offensive end when they've been dodging, going hard, creating slides, forcing the Denver defense to honor them. So they've got to win the draw, and they've got to go down and make the most of their offensive possessions, put shots on cage, and force Denver to withstand the pressure.
So when you look at kind of Maryland's defense, this season coming into this year were pretty highly touted. They added Marge Donovan. They returned Abby Bosco and Emily Sterling, the national leaders in their positions. And they have conceded 8 goals today. And on the season, they are averaging, you know, conceding about 13, almost 14 goals a game. This has been, while they are trailing, it has been a bit of a better defensive performance.
I definitely think from game to game, the defense for the Terps has gotten better. There's a lot of returners, a lot of older players, but they're still trying to figure out how to jive with one another, how each other likes to play. And so they're starting to grow. You see them start to put the pieces together little by little in these first couple of games.
So the teams have retaken the field to a resounding Maryland faithful encouragement. And what really is a gorgeous day here in College Park. You really can't ask for much better. About 61 degrees right now. And Maryland has about 6 minutes to find 2 goals to push this into overtime. Back to the draw circle. 9-8 in favor of Denver.
It's going to be a hold on that draw. Kennedy Major won it out of the air, and then the Denver attacker closest to her just held on to her stick a little bit too long to try to get that check off.
So Maryland comes the other way, left to right. Bosco, Lamoureux.
There's no time left to waste possessions if you're Maryland. These need to be executed. Ball needs to be put in the back of the net.
16 turnovers on the afternoon for the Terrapins. They average only about 9 a game. Not the cleanest Maryland performance. Now back on their home turf since the first game of the season. Here's Ahern. Clevenger. Lipkin. Hench to Edmondson. Ahern again. Approaching 30 seconds left on the shot clock. Here's Hench. Lubecker to Clevenger. That one loose on the ground and scooped up by Denver.
That's a good look there. Libby May was wide open, but ball put a little bit too far behind her, so she had to reach for it. Not exactly the play that you wanted to come out of that offensive possession.
Here come the Pioneers. Megan Klingenberg, the freshman, gets it forward.
Denver's now able to get this down to about 3:10 on the game clock left. That is if they don't score.
They've only done so once here in the fourth quarter. Maryland has not scored at all in the fourth. That's how you get to this 8-6 lead for Denver. What would be the first ever win for Denver over Maryland in series history? Here's Black. Forced back out by the double team. Rude and Lamoureux were in pursuit. Now Curry will slow things down. 20 seconds left on the shot clock. Estep passes up top. DeRose. Feeds to the near side. Now Curry. And she will dump that one to the corner as the shot clock expired.
It's a really smart play if you're Denver. They didn't get a quality look. You had about 5 seconds left on that shot clock. Throw to the corner, force Maryland to clear the full length of the field, and then force them to go play offense against their zone, which they've been struggling with today.
Under 3 minutes left to play here in College Park in the stick of Hannah Lubecker, two-time All-American. Now Elle Clevenger. Pass the near side for May. A shot there and a save by Bohee. A good one at that. And Maryland will keep possession in a new shot clock. Lubecker. Ahern. Pass over to the far side for Hench. Now Jordan Lipkin. Clevenger. Up top, Edmondson. Clevenger behind the cage. And a whistle against Denver. Victoria Hench was looking to go towards the cage, and the Pioneers whistled for a foul.
That's one of those shooting space calls that I don't think was actually a shooting space call. I think there have been others that haven't been called that were, but that's one where I thought the defender had a nice approach.
Hench from outside left has that one knocked, but looks like she got a stick to the face.
That's going to be a yellow card on Denver's number 0, Bryn McCoy. Taylor Hench rolled to the inside, and then that sweep, oh, that actually looked to be Sam Thacker, got her right on the goggles.
It looks like now they have correctly identified Thacker as the culprit. And 1:59 left on the game clock. The Terrapins trail by 2.
It'll be interesting here to see whether they shoot this.
Hench scores! Victoria Hench brings Maryland within one with under 2 minutes to play.
That's always one that, as a coach, you don't know whether to have them pull it out or shoot. And in that case, Tori Hench, very confident on the eight-meter line, sticks it low and through Bowie's legs, I believe, able to inch the Terps closer.
Well, Victoria Hench was that big game player in the ranked win over Florida a few games ago, where she scored the game winner with 17 seconds left. And a very important goal once again here for Maryland as they now trail by 1.
This is a must-win draw for both teams. If you're Denver and you win the draw, you're able to bring the shot clock down, or the whole clock down, to about 27 seconds. If you're Maryland, you win this draw, you have a final possession to see if you can tie it up.
Tied at 9 in the draw circle today. Also worth noting, Maryland has 9 fouls this afternoon. Denver has 24. And it's scooped up by Maryland. Shannon Smith able to corral it off the turf. And we're going to have a timeout here from Maryland as they look to get set here for what could be that final possession. We will step aside quickly here on Big Ten Plus. A one-goal game coming down to the wire. We'll be back in just a second. 1:47 left to play in a top 10 matchup in College Park. It truly has been a thriller so far this afternoon, and plenty of time left for more drama to come to fruition. Brendan Hartlove, Taylor Cummings here. Very excited to be bringing you this action, which has been kind of a roller coaster of a game. Maryland jumped out to an early two-goal lead. Denver stormed back and took, you know, control of this game. And Maryland has been able to come back into it with a big third quarter, scoring three goals. And now they trail by one. They controlled the draw. They took a timeout. 1:47 left on the clock. Any guesses, Taylor?
Well, first steps first, you got to clear. Right. And Denver's done a really good job riding, making things difficult. Their goal right now, if they can create a turnover, awesome. But at minimum, they want to make sure that they take as much time off the clock as possible. So step one, they were able to get the ball over the 30. Now they have 64 seconds left with which to work to try to get a shot on cage.
Potential for overtime here in College Park. More on that if it becomes more relevant. Terps still with a bit of work to do. Here's Ahern. Clevenger. Lipkin. Hench. Passes off to Edmondson. Already has a hat trick. Here's May, the senior. Patience the key for Maryland, but time of the essence. Ahern. Edmondson through traffic. Low shot and a save. Amelia Bohe comes up with a crucial stop in the final minute of regulation.
That's about as good of a take you're going to get if you're Maryland. Again, I like the confidence to take that hard to cage. The Red Sea kind of parted. She had to take that dodge. But now Hannah Lubecker forces a turnover. 28 seconds left. Let's see what she does with it.
Something could be on here for the Terps. A low bouncing shot rolls comfortably into the stick, but there is a whistle.
Looks like there's going to be an 8-meter. Hannah Lubecker, I couldn't tell whether she was looking to shoot this. I believe she was. That, honestly, I'm kind of surprised they called that foul. Now you have one of the Terps' top shooters on the 8-meter line. So from the Denver perspective, not on the 8-meter line. Denver perspective, Denver fan perspective, I understand why they're frustrated with that.
So Lubecker gets it back underway and could not connect with Hench. It rolls out, will stay with Maryland. 13 seconds left. Or goes to Denver, excuse me. Loose on the ground. Bohe has lost it. And it stays with Maryland. 6 seconds left. And we have a whistle. Why would it be a straightforward end to the game?
Denver's going to look to double behind. Triple team, actually.
6.6 seconds to be exact. Maryland trails by one to Denver. The Pioneers have never beaten Maryland in the entirety of the series history.
My guess is Tori Hench, assuming this ball stays with Maryland, they're going to have a flood of cutters into the eight. You just got to kind of either pop it up. I'd probably look to hit whoever's on that nearest elbow, Hannah Lubecker, if she's left open, and see if we can generate a free position shot or a good opportunity. And now we've got a timeout for Maryland.
So it only feels fitting to stay with you here, as this is kind of the climax of this contest. 6.6 seconds for Maryland. They have the ball. They're likely going to get a triple team on the restart. And it is kitchen sink time for Maryland. Taylor, you've been in these situations before. What is the feeling of a player on the field right now?
I mean, you've got to be confident. There's no room for nerves. There's no room for what ifs. At this point, you have a little under 7 seconds to make something happen. So right now, Kathy Reese, Caitlin Phipps, Alex Oss, they're going to be drawing something up on that offensive end. It's got to be quick. So it's a very short-lived play, but if you're on that field, you have to be ready to take the shot in a big moment.
You and I were talking before the game about how Maryland has some older players, but not all of them are the experienced players, and there is a big difference between age and experience. Maryland has age. They're lacking a little bit of experience. Yes, you have May, you have Lou Becker, and you have some, you know, playing time experience from the players like Clevenger, but this is a do-or-die moment for Maryland right now. It would be two straight losses for Maryland.
Yeah, this is something that, you know, the Terps, oh, I believe by the way that Denver is, or Maryland is set up, Denver actually has this ball right now. So a little bit different than the look that we were anticipating. There's a triple team right now on Denver, on McCoy.
The plot thickens in College Park. Maryland is 160-5 at home under Kathy Reese. And that will do it. Denver upsets Maryland. Number 9 takes down number 5, and the Pioneers beat the Terrapins for the first time in history. It came all the way down to the wire. And Denver picks up back-to-back wins over ranked opponents. Truly a historic day in the history of Denver women's lacrosse.
What a huge win for Denver. Able to go to Michigan, get a win, come to Maryland, get a win. I believe they're 6-0 on the season now. I was really impressed with their discipline. Their zone is very, very difficult to crack. And their offense took advantage of opportunities. There weren't a ton, but they took advantage of the opportunities they were given.
So a roller coaster of a game here, and that's exactly what you should come to expect when you have a top 10 matchup in College Park, Maryland. The Terps jumped out to an early lead, and Denver stormed back to take control of the contest. And in the end, the Pioneers hold on to be victorious. For Taylor Cummings and our entire Big Ten Plus crew, I'm Brennan Hartlove saying so long from College Park. Your final score, number 9 Denver over number 5 Maryland, 8-7.